Genuinely today, three people can do the work of 10 people on the set at any given time. Insane if the pricing of the ticket changes. Post-COVID period, you're gonna have to think even bigger to attract people to come and spend money in a cinema theater.
Hi everyone, and joining us today is one of the top producers of the industry. We have Ronnie Sruvala with us. You know, speaking about the business, you've been in the industry for so long, you know the in and outs of it, you know how it works. What do you see changing from here on post-COVID?
You know, I think we take the consumer for granted a lot. I think the consumer has evolved very rapidly. We are in the COVID period. Depending on how long it lasts, will depend how permanent is the mindset change of people and consumer habits. If it lasts for 6 months, there'll be a certain impact. If it lasts for 18 months, it's a change in lifestyle for a lot of people, change of priorities. For the next 2 years, I feel that the pain in terms of economy and economic spend is going to be very important. So I think that the wallet share, what people spend out of every 100 rupees that you earn, will change in priority towards health, towards education, towards savings, towards sustenance, towards a rainy day.
Right.
And therefore, the share of what was there for disposable income, for enjoyment, or for restaurants, or for entertainment, or for stepping out, and all of that, or travel, I think for the next 2 years is going to shrink. Therefore, cinema has to go to the absolute next level of storytelling.
Will we see making of like the big budget Rohit Shetty films?
Cinema is something, and storytelling is something that needs to be told at scale. In fact, I think after the in-COVID period and going to the post-COVID period, you're gonna have to think even bigger to attract people to come and spend money in a cinema theater, sit through an interval, sit through 15 minutes of advertising junk, okay, and make a 2 hour, 20 minute viewing experience into a 3.5 hour viewing experience, which is quite painful. And the younger audience, in any way, is actually sort of rejecting that to some level.
How do you see the sets could look like? What do you think the numbers on the set will look like?
On a shooting, look, I have to tell you, we just don't have that discipline. We don't have the mindset. We'll have to force ourselves into it. Like, everyone didn't realize that you can actually carry on and work without necessarily meeting each other and traveling distances and getting traffic till a situation arose, and therefore we were forced to look at that. I think we don't need more than 50% of the people on a set that are on a set.
One conversation that generally comes to mind with regards to this is that, you know, we have stars, okay, we have their entourage also. I mean,
Yes, I understand that. But those entourages will have to contract, because those stars will have to understand that even today, by sitting at home, the entourage is not visiting them. So they'll have to get real about it. If they really want to be back in business and shoot, they'll have to just, the penny will have to drop. I think it's going to get forced. The problem is, it's not going to be voluntary. That's the unfortunate part.
what are the pay cuts or what are the, I mean, obviously the numbers will shrink. The pay
Which
cuts,
number?
the numbers of the people on the set will shrink.
Yeah, and I think that's just because of efficiency. Look, I'm not here saying that. I'd much rather for us to figure out how we can be more efficient with that labor force, whether it's the light people, the camera assistants, the spot boys, whatever else, which is a very, very important part of the ecosystem. I think my empathy for that, for the people who earn less, is 10 times more. But we still need to find a solution. So it's rather that we can pay three times the amount to less people and get the same amount of work, and that's how it needs to get done. And I don't think we do that. Genuinely today, three people can do the work of 10 people on the set at any given time.
How do you see it in terms of like the big stars? Okay, do you think everyone will have to take a pay cut and adjust with that?
See, that's a whole new different context. Nobody takes a voluntary pay cut. No CEO comes to the board and says, I'm taking a pay cut. I mean, some do. And actually, those are the ones that are the long-term leaders. But most people are not going to come with a voluntary pay cut. I think the industry will define that. If less and less studios are there to fund the ambitions of people who want to tell stories, then the whole value chain is going to get affected. And there'll be two or three actors who'll say, I don't give a shit, and I'll put all my money in. But if they're doing that, then what they pay themselves is actually esoteric, and it's notional, because it's from left pocket to right pocket. Then I can keep my ego up, and I can keep my market value, whatever I want it to be, but it's completely theoretical and esoteric.
You know, job loss. I want to understand from you what has it been like for you particularly, because we know that you know, Rashmi Rocket was in production. So what has it been like in terms of projects that we were expecting to come out for you
No,
personally?
but I don't think it's a question of job loss, because, for example, I mean, as I said, we have 1,000 people working for us at UpGrad. I have 300 people working for me at Swadesh, and we have another 3,000 people working in other companies. In RSVP, we have a team of nine. So I don't have a context of a job loss when it comes to the media and entertainment part. It's basically everyone comes with a contract of that assignment. There, the calendar is moved. Now, yes, for 5-6 months, if there's no shooting, then everyone's installed capacity for 6 months has gone to zero. But it's no different than a migrant labor who was a restaurant person who was working in a restaurant. And for 6 months, if he didn't have it on his daily wage, he didn't earn it.
Well, you know, but one thing that obviously comes to my mind personally is the viewing pattern of the audiences. You know, we're sitting in the comforts of our home. We're seeing big releases come out. Gulabo Sitabo is going to be out on Prime Video very soon. Gunjan Saxena acquired by Netflix. So how do you think that's going to change for the film business in general? Do you think the...
I think it's perfectly fine. If we have got the maximum number of movies being produced in the country, in the world, 1,000 movies, even if 100 of them go on to digital as premieres, what's the big deal? The beauty is the market will expand. It won't contract. It's just that we're so obsessive about the fact that, oh, some of these 8 movies, they've gone. They have a timing problem. Nobody knows when we're going to release movies. I don't think cinemas are going to open until at least end of September. If there's a 50% or 40% distancing norm, cinema theaters will keep saying, oh, but we're already working at 35% occupancy, so actually it's fine. That's hogwash, absolute rubbish, because the simple reason is the weekend traffic is really what makes it. And if you don't get that weekend traffic, then the weekdays, after a week, the charm of going to the cinema for a premiere already recedes. The economics is going to change very substantially there.
But then the pricing of the ticket will also change, right?
I mean, that'll be insane if the pricing of the ticket changes. And I think because then you're alienating this audience even more. Because in India, whether we like it or not, I think for weekends, we overcharge the multiplex. Second, we make them oversit with 20 minutes of subjective advertising time. When I've already paid 400 rupees for a ticket, why do I have to stand for 15 minutes and have to buy popcorn just so that I can get rid of the ads so that the cinema theater can do more? So if they start increasing prices, yeah, I mean, that's one more nail in the coffin.
But, you know, Ronnie, you're saying that it's just 100 films that are going on OTT. But I want to understand that, you know, does the charm of cinema, like cinema...
I'm sold on cinema. I think it's a fantastic habit. It's not going away. It will morph. I'm not even saying it'll shrink, because the bigger tent poles could attract higher box offices. In India, we've been insanely following and patting ourselves in the back when nobody's patting us anyway. So we self-pat ourselves in the back when there's 100 crore. For the last 8 years, we've been saying 100 crores. There's inflation of 7-9% a year. We should be at least saying 200 crores to 100 crore. We keep saying 100 crore club, 200 crore club. There may be less movies that'll really do well at the theater. And those could be double the potential of what they were before. And so that's how we need to look at that cinema.
Do you see lesser films being made then?
No, I don't see in India lesser films being made, because it's just such a passion and such an obsession. And every single, there's always 20 new people that want to fund a film every year. For the next 1 year, yes. I think even people who want to do it as a passion project may not be having the money to put out right now. And anyway, I think next year you're going to see a further drought, because if for 6 months we haven't shot any films,
yeah,
the impact will be felt in June of 21 to December 21, where suddenly there'll be not much to release. And I think even Hollywood will have to time it to their global releases. I mean, I heard some of the cinema saying, oh, July, we've got 2 Hollywood releases. And I was laughing and thinking, but they're not releasing it in America. You think they're going to come here and release it in India? What are you talking about?
But do you see conversation coming back to piracy now? Because when these movies are being released, when these TVs are making it to you know, OTT platforms, a lot of people, a big chunk of the audiences we might not be aware of, as so to say, but they are downloading it off torrents and watching it. That being a problem?
I see that as a problem going forward. It was always a problem. I don't see it right now being that much of an additional problem that is a pain. We need to solve some of the other economics of the situation right now more than anything else.
This particular story theme is something that we should talk about in as many ways as we can. But how does having somebody like Vidya change it for you? Like, change it for the film?
I think Vidya was a natural person for us to go to with this story, because she brings a certain sense of gravitas. In her mind, if you look at her as a person and a human being, even before the actor, this is how she lives her life. She's a strong family person, and she understands and stands up for causes. I think, therefore, she brings a lot of gravitas to the table. And when you're making a short film, when you want to get attention, outside of the narrative, having somebody who's a known face and bringing that out immediately brings credibility, curiosity, and viewership.
Thank you so much for doing this. You gave us a lot of insight into what it could look like. Thank you so much for doing this, Ronnie.
Thank you.